Let us start this class with quickly revising what we have already learned in the previous class. In the previous class, we came to know the mechanism of action of the typical antipsychotic drugs or the first generation antipsychotic drugs. And we also came to know how it differs from the second generation antipsychotics. So we have seen that the typical antipsychotics, they antagonize the D2 receptors and their antagonism of D2 receptors in the mesolimbic pathway is mainly responsible for their beneficial effect, particularly with respect to their response with respect to improvement in positive symptoms. But they are inhibiting the dopamine receptors in other dopamine pathways also. For example, in the nigrostriatal pathway, the inhibition of dopamine receptors are leading to the extrapyramidal side effects. And we have seen that extrapyramidal side effect, apart from the other side effects, are the major drawbacks of the antipsychotic drugs, particularly the first generation antipsychotics. Because the first generation antipsychotics, they have got a greater affinity for inhibiting the D2 receptors, and that is mainly responsible for their extrapyramidal side effects. So we have noticed that because of these extrapyramidal side effects, in many cases the second generation antipsychotics are preferred. And we have seen that second generation antipsychotics, they give better response in both positive symptoms as well as in negative symptoms, because apart from inhibiting the D2 receptors, they have got antagonistic action against 5-HT receptors. And as far as dopamine receptor is concerned, they are inhibiting D4, D3, and they have got lesser affinity for D2 receptors. So broadly, we can say that the first generation antipsychotics, they are better for positive symptoms, and second generation antipsychotics, they are better for negative symptoms. But this is a broad rule, not applicable everywhere and every time, but this is the bottom line. Now let us first start this class with the discussion of the adverse effects of antipsychotics. Now if you recall the adverse effects or what we have discussed just now, we have noticed that extrapyramidal side effects are the major side effects of the antipsychotics. And these extrapyramidal side effects is mainly happening because of the dopamine blockade in the nigrostriatal pathway. And if you see the types of extrapyramidal symptoms, these are acute dystonia, Parkinsonism, akathisia, and tardive dyskinesia. Now before proceeding, just a common question, and the answer for this we have already discussed. I know you must be knowing the answer for this. Extrapyramidal side effects are common with the typical antipsychotics. Why?
Because of
because of the D2 antagonism in the nigrostatin pathway. So it is as simple as this. Now let us understand the role of centrally acting anticholinergic agents in the treatment of extrapyramidal symptoms or in the treatment of drug-induced Parkinsonism. In the nigrostatin pathway, there is a delicate balance between dopamine and acetylcholine. And this balance between dopamine and acetylcholine, it basically allows the normal movement. Dopamine has got an inhibitory influence, whereas acetylcholine has got the excitatory influence. So there is a balance between the inhibitory influence of dopamine and excitatory influence of the acetylcholine. Now what we have noticed just now, the antipsychotics, particularly the typical antipsychotics, they are mainly blocking the D2 receptors. So dopamine blocking is being done by the antipsychotics. So if there is dopamine blocking, it will result in increased cholinergic activity, or the balance will be tilted towards the acetylcholine because there is dopamine blockade. Are you getting my point? So this is what happens when you prescribe an antipsychotic, or to be more precise, if you prescribe typical antipsychotics to a patient suffering from psychosis, the balance in the nigrostatin pathway will be tilted towards acetylcholine. So you have to lower down this level of acetylcholine for a normal movement to happen. And for this purpose, we prescribe centrally acting anticholinergic drugs for treating drug-induced Parkinsonism or for treating extrapyramidal symptoms. So broadly, this is the rule, but centrally acting anticholinergic medication can take care of almost all the types of extrapyramidal symptoms except one. This we will know just after a few moments. But just remember that for drug-induced Parkinsonism, the drug of choice is centrally acting anticholinergic drugs. For example, benzatropine, procyclidine. Now we can classify the extrapyramidal symptoms based on their occurrence, or based on their time-dependent occurrence, into acute onset extrapyramidal symptoms, medium-term onset extrapyramidal symptoms, and the extrapyramidal symptoms which appears after many months or many years of the usage of the antipsychotics, or the chronic appearance type of extrapyramidal symptoms. So, both acute and medium term extrapyramidal symptoms, we can club it together as early phase extrapyramidal symptoms. These are reversible. These can be reversed by the treatment, mostly by treating with centrally acting anticholinergic agents. But this late phase extrapyramidal symptoms, that is tardive dyskinesia, it is irreversible. And in fact, centrally acting anticholinergic agents are contraindicated in tardive dyskinesia. Now, just now I have told you that in extrapyramidal symptoms, centrally acting anticholinergic agents have got a good role to play. But why it is not prescribed in treating tardive dyskinesia? Just think about it. We will come to this point later on. So, the early phase extrapyramidal symptoms such as acute dystonia. Acute dystonia mostly happens within hours or within few days of the treatment of antipsychotic agents. And it is characterized by very bizarre type of muscle spasm. Then akathisia is usually a medium term onset type of extrapyramidal symptom, and it appears within 1 to 8 weeks. And in akathisia, patient will be unable to remain seated in one particular place or one particular posture because of motor restlessness. Then drug-induced Parkinsonism or Parkinson's-like symptoms, it appears within weeks to months of starting the antipsychotic agents, and it is characterized by rigidity, tremor, hypokinesia, mask-like face, shuffling gait. And the late phase extrapyramidal symptoms, that is tardive dyskinesia, it is characterized by inappropriate postures of the neck, trunk, limbs, and it happens with long-term usage of particularly high potency typical antipsychotic agents. It appears after many months or many years of the treatment with the antipsychotic agents, and it is irreversible. Now let us start with acute dystonia. In acute dystonia, I told you that it usually appears in the beginning of the therapy. It appears within hours to days of starting the antipsychotics. And in this, there is fixed muscle posture with the spasm. There is muscle spasm of the tongue, face, neck, and back. Facial expression is most often it is ugly. There is tongue thirsting. Head becomes persistently turned to one side. There is locked jaw. And mostly seen in young males. And the treatment for this acute dystonia is central anticholinergic agents such as procyclidine or benzotropine, IM or IV. So what is the rationale for prescribing anticholinergic agents here? In the nigrostatal pathway, there is a delicate balance between dopamine and acetylcholine. And while you prescribe D2 antagonistic agent, there will be dopamine blockade. So the balance will be tilted towards acetylcholine. So you have to tone down that acetylcholine level, and for that you are prescribing centrally acting anticholinergic agents. And why you are not prescribing levodopa? for drug induced Parkinsonism that we will discuss, actually dopamine receptors are already occupied, already blocked. So there is no role of levodopa like drug. Then akathisia. As I have told you, it is characterized by the constant compulsion of the patient to be in motion. But the unfortunate thing is that though the patient will have a constant urge to move, but that movement will not relieve his symptom or his distress. Again, in this we prescribe anticholinergics. Apart from that, we can prescribe benzodiazepines or propranolol. Then drug induced Parkinsonism. As I have already told you, it is induced by the blocking of D2 receptor in the nigrostatin pathway, and it appears after few weeks to few months of the treatment. And in this, the drug of choice is centrally acting anticholinergic agents. The other thing that you can do for tackling these extrapyramidal symptoms, if patient is on typical antipsychotics, you can preferably switch to the atypical antipsychotics, because atypical antipsychotics, they have got less tendency to cause extrapyramidal side effect. Or you can reduce the dose and then you can gradually switch to the atypical antipsychotics. Then let us come to the chronic onset extrapyramidal symptom, which is irreversible and which appears after many months or many years of the treatment with the highly potent typical antipsychotics. And mostly the elderly patients who have been treated with the higher doses of the typical antipsychotics, particularly the potent typical antipsychotics, they are at highest risk. And it is characterized by purposeless involuntary movement of mouth, lips and tongues. And it is irreversible. Now, in the tardive dyskinesia, as I have told you earlier, centrally acting anticholinergic agents have got no role to play whatsoever. Why it is so? Just now I have told you that centrally acting anticholinergic agents have got a very good role to play in treating extrapyramidal symptoms, but why it is not preferred in tardive dyskinesia? See, what happens if you persistently block the dopamine receptor for a very longer period? What it will do? Upregulation. So this is actually what is happening. This blocking of the dopamine receptor in the nigrostatin pathway is actually leading to the upregulation of dopamine receptors. And these receptors are super sensitive to the action of dopamine. Now, what has happened? See, initially when you started dopamine antagonist, the balance tilted towards acetylcholine. After prescribing dopamine antagonist for many months or many years in a higher dose, the balance has again tilted towards dopamine. Dopamine has overpowered the acetylcholine. See, there is a upregulation of dopamine receptor because of constant blocking of the dopamine receptor in the nigrostatyl pathway. Are you getting my point? The dopamine receptor was constantly blocked for many years, and in consequence to that, there is an upregulation of dopamine receptor. You all have read the concept of downregulation and upregulation of the receptors. So just apply that concept here. So this constant blockade of the dopamine receptor has led to upregulation of the dopamine receptor, and these upregulated dopamine receptor are highly sensitive to the actions of dopamine. So the thing is, after many years of using dopamine antagonist, the balance has again tilted towards dopamine. So it means that the cholinergic input has been overpowered. There is lesser amount of cholinergic input in contrast to the dopamine input. Now, if you prescribe anticholinergic agents or centrally acting anticholinergic agents, what it will do? It will actually accentuate the tardive dyskinesia, because already there is less cholinergic input, and now you are over and above that you are prescribing anticholinergic agents. So it will, it will lead to more blockade of the cholinergic receptor. So that is not required here. Are you getting my point? So that is the reason centrally acting anticholinergic agents are contraindicated in tardive dyskinesia, in contrast to the other type of extrapyramidal symptoms. So at best, what you can do, again, you should try to switch to the atypical antipsychotics, which has got lesser potential to cause extrapyramidal symptoms. Now, why atypical antipsychotics have got lesser potential to cause tardive dyskinesia? Again, the answer is same, because they have got more potential to block the 5-HT receptor compared to the D2 receptors. Now, this was all about the extrapyramidal symptoms or extrapyramidal side effects. Now let us talk about the other side effects of antipsychotics. In the previous class, I have told you that antipsychotics, whether they are first generation antipsychotic or typical antipsychotic or the second generation antipsychotic or the atypical antipsychotic, they also block the histamine receptor or muscarinic receptor or alpha adrenergic receptors. There might be some minor differences here or there that we will discuss while discussing the individual drugs, but overall, both first generation and second generation antipsychotics are blocking the histamine receptors, muscarinic receptors and alpha adrenergic receptors. Now, blocking of histamine receptors, H1 receptor, will lead to sedation and weight gain. Among the first generation antipsychotics, chlorpromazine have got a higher risk of causing sedation and weight gain than among the second generation antipsychotics. Clozapine have got a higher chances of causing sedation and weight gain because of blocking of the histamine receptors. Then blocking of muscarinic receptors leading to anti-muscarinic side effects such as constipation, blurred vision is highest with clozapine. Then alpha adrenergic blocking can lead to orthostatic hypotension. Metabolic side effects. As far as metabolic side effects are concerned, though the atypical antipsychotics, they have got less chances to cause extrapyramidal side effect, but they have got higher chances of causing the metabolic side effects such as dyslipidemia, significant weight gain, hyperglycemia. Now let us discuss the individual agents among the first generation antipsychotics, and then we will discuss the individual agents of the second generation antipsychotics. The first generation antipsychotics, we can further classify them as high potency and lower potency. High potency first generation antipsychotics examples are haloperidol, fluphenazine, and then there are other examples, but at least remember these two drugs. And low potency first generation antipsychotics are most important among them is chlorpromazine. Now let us try to understand the difference between the low potency first generation antipsychotic and high potency first generation antipsychotic. Both have got advantages and disadvantages. High potency first generation antipsychotics such as haloperidol because of their blocking of the D2 receptors and because of the less blocking of the muscarinic receptor, so they are highly potent in blocking the D2 receptor, but they have got less chance to block the muscarinic receptor. Because of that, they have got higher risk for causing extrapyramidal symptoms. See, if a drug is blocking the D2 receptor but it has got higher antimuscarinic activity, to an extent it can compensate for the higher incidence of extrapyramidal symptom or this high chances of blocking the muscarinic activity or increased antimuscarinic activity will actually lead to less incidence of extrapyramidal symptom. So we can understand it in this way. There is an inverse relationship between extrapyramidal symptom and antimuscarinic activity. If there is increased antimuscarinic activity for any particular drug which is blocking the D2 receptor, the chances for causing extrapyramidal symptom will be less. So the low potency first generation antipsychotics, though they are blocking the D2 receptor, but they have got higher antimuscarinic activity. So the chances of extrapyramidal symptom will be less. And in contrast to that, high potency antipsychotics or high potency first generation antipsychotic, they have got higher potency to block the D2 receptor, but they have got less antimuscarinic activity. So the chances of extrapyramidal symptom will be more with the high potency drug. Are you getting my point? But the thing is, these low potency first generation antipsychotic, apart from having increased antimuscarinic activity, they are also blocking the histamine receptors, alpha adrenergic receptors. So these can lead to increased incidence of side effects such as sedation or postural hypotension. But because the higher potency typical antipsychotics, they have got lesser chances of or lesser antimuscarinic activity and lesser alpha blocking activity, the chances of orthostatic hypotension or sedation are less with the higher potency antipsychotics. So we can summarize that if an antipsychotic or a typical antipsychotic is blocking the D2 receptor, but it has got increased antimuscarinic activity, the chances of extrapyramidal symptom will be less. Whereas if the drug is blocking the D2 receptor, but it has got decreased antimuscarinic activity, the chances of extrapyramidal symptom will be more. So this is the basic difference between the low potency and high potency typical antipsychotics. And high potency antipsychotics have got a higher potency to block the D2 receptor. As you can see in this table, let us take two examples, clorpromazine or CPZ, which is a low potency first generation antipsychotic, and haloperidol, which is a high potency first generation antipsychotic. And what are the differences that you are noticing? See, if you correlate the extrapyramidal symptom and the antimuscarinic activity, CPZ has got a lesser chances of causing extrapyramidal symptom. It doesn't mean that it doesn't cause extrapyramidal symptom. The chances of causing extrapyramidal symptom is less with the CPZ, whereas it is higher with the haloperidol. And now just compare their antimuscarinic activity. The antimuscarinic activity of CPZ is higher compared to haloperidol. But now let us focus on the sedation aspect. Antimuscarinic activity is higher apart from the histamine blocking activity. Chances of sedation with CPZ is higher compared to haloperidol. So these are the basic differences that you need to remember. So to sum up the adverse effects of the typical antipsychotics, the one category of adverse effect is related to the D2 antagonism, that is extrapyramidal symptoms. Then the other category of adverse effects are related to histamine blocking or muscarinic blocking or the alpha adrenergic blocking. Then D2 blocking in the tuberoinfundibular pathway will also lead to increased prolactin release. Now let us focus on the atypical antipsychotics. The focus will be on understanding the difference between the individual atypical antipsychotics. But before that, just quickly revise what are the broad differences between typical and atypical antipsychotic. Atypical antipsychotics, they can treat both positive as well as negative symptom because they are antagonizing the 5-HT receptors as well as they are blocking the dopamine receptor, though they have got less affinity for D2 receptor, but they are blocking other receptors such as D4 or D3. As opposed to typical antipsychotic, atypical antipsychotic are more loosely bound to the D2 receptor. And they have got lesser chances to cause extrapyramidal symptoms. And because of these reasons, they are more preferred compared to the typical antipsychotics. Now let us see the examples of some individual atypical antipsychotics such as clozapine, olanzapine, risperidone. If you see their affinity for various receptors, what you are noticing here? All the atypical antipsychotics, they are blocking the 5-HT2 receptors. But they are also blocking the histamine receptors, muscarinic receptors, alpha adrenergic receptor. But if you take a case of risperidone, what difference you are noticing here? What I have told you, atypical antipsychotics, they have got lesser affinity for D2 receptor. But in case of risperidone, which is basically an atypical antipsychotic, but it has got higher affinity for D2 receptor, same as that of the typical antipsychotic. So it is basically, to an extent, it has got similar action to that of typical antipsychotic because it has got higher affinity for the D2 antagonism compared to the D4. And they also lack the anticholinergic activity. Now, can you correlate these things? It has got higher affinity for D2 blocking and it is lacking anticholinergic activity. So the chances of extrapyramidal symptom will be high or less? It will be high. So risperidone, though it is a typical antipsychotic, but because it has got higher affinity for blocking the D2 receptor and it has got negligible anti-muscarinic activity, the chances of extrapyramidal symptom will be high with risperidone. Now let us discuss about clozapine. It was the first atypical antipsychotic to be launched in the market, but it was withdrawn after being launched. Why it was withdrawn? Agranulocytosis. It was seen that it was leading to very higher incidence of agranulocytosis. But later on it was relaunched because it was noticed that it has got some good activity, particularly patients who are resistant to the other antipsychotic, they respond to this particular drug, and the chances of extrapyramidal symptoms are also less. So it was again launched. So it is a potent antagonist at D4 receptor, but it has got lesser affinity for D2 blocking. So higher affinity for D4, lesser affinity for D2, and it is blocking the 5-HT2A receptors. Apart from that, it has also got alpha adrenergic blocking action and muscarinic blocking action and histamine blocking action or H1 blocking action. Now, because it is blocking both D4, D2, though with less affinity, it is blocking the D2 receptor, and it is also blocking the 5-HT2 receptor, it can be useful in treating both positive as well as negative symptoms of schizophrenia. And the best thing is that it shows response in even treatment resistant patients who are not responding to other treatment. They respond to the therapy with clozapine. In fact, 30% response rate in severely ill treatment resistant patients has been noticed. But because it leads to agranulocytosis, regular WBC count monitoring is required with clozapine. Apart from agranulocytosis, because it is blocking the H1 receptor, because it is blocking the muscarinic receptors, because it is blocking the alpha adrenergic receptor, it is associated with the other side effects, particularly weight gain, sedation, and other anti-muscarinic side effects, and there is risk of seizure also, and it can also lead to myocarditis, and it is costly. So clozapine should only be used in patients who are not responding to the other therapies. But you need to regularly monitor the WBC count. So you have to regularly monitor the WBC, and the cost of clozapine is also high. So the cost part is one of the aspects that you need to think about before starting the clozapine. But the good thing is that it is one of the very effective antipsychotic drug, particularly in treatment resistant cases or in refractory schizophrenia, and it gives a response in treating both positive as well as negative symptoms. Now let us discuss about another drug, olanzapine. Olanzapine, we can say that olanzapine is clozapine without the risk of agranulocytosis. So if a drug is giving you all the advantages of clozapine without its major disadvantage, then it can be a very good drug, because it has got same therapeutic effectiveness and same adverse effect profile, except the risk of agranulocytosis. Then risperidone. What I had told you about risperidone, similar to the typical antipsychotic, it has got higher affinity for blocking the D2 receptor, but it is also blocking the 5-HT2 receptor. So we can say it has got the activity similar to that of typical antipsychotic and activity similar to that of atypical antipsychotic. But the thing is, this more potent D2 antagonism is associated with lesser or negligible or nil antimuscarinic activity. So more potent D2 blocking and negligible anti-muscarinic activity, it leads to higher chances of extrapyramidal symptom. So it can lead to dose related extrapyramidal symptom, and the risk of extrapyramidal symptom is higher with the higher dosage of risperidone, particularly if you use more than 6 milligram per day dosage of risperidone. And it also increases the prolactin level, and it should not be given to patients with breast cancer. And it has got higher affinity for blocking alpha adrenergic receptors and histamine receptor, though it do not block the muscarinic receptor. So the chances of postural hypotension will be there. So what we have noticed, as far as atypical antipsychotics are concerned, they treat both positive and negative symptoms. The chances of extrapyramidal symptom is less, but there are exceptions. For example, risperidone. Another disadvantage that we have already discussed with atypical antipsychotic is that they have got higher chances of causing the metabolic side effects, such as weight gain, diabetes, hyperlipidemia. So with this, we have discussed about typical and atypical antipsychotics. In the last segment of this class, I will take another 5 minutes. I will briefly discuss the treatment for bipolar disorders. All of you must be knowing about bipolar disorders. For bipolar disorder, we use mood stabilizers such as lithium, or we can use some anticonvulsant. Which anticonvulsant we can use? Do you remember? Sodium valproate, carbamazepine. Or you can use certain atypical antipsychotics, with mood stabilizer, or you can use antidepressants with mood stabilizers. So lithium salts, either lithium carbonate or lithium citrate, are the most commonly prescribed mood stabilizer. And lithium is a monovalent ion that enters the neuron, but it is not easily removed. And lithiums, or the use of lithium, gives you 60 to 80% success in reducing the acute manic and hypomanic cases, and it reduces the risk of suicide related to bipolar disorder. And the basic mechanism of action is reduction of the IP3 second messenger, resulting in reduced activity of PIP2 dependent pathway. But lithium is a low therapeutic index drug, so therapeutic drug monitoring is required, because adverse effect will be seen with the higher plasma concentration of lithium. So adverse effects are dose dependent and concentration dependent. And the GIT symptoms such as nausea, vomiting, diarrhea are the earliest symptoms of toxicity. If concentration is very high, it can lead to CNS toxicity. Seizures can happen. On long-term use, it can lead to renal diabetes insipidus, weight gain, and hypothyroidism. And it is contraindicated in pregnancy. Now there is one interesting drug interaction between diuretics such as thiazides and lithium. See, diuretic, what it causes? It causes sodium loss. Now, in consequence to that sodium loss, there will be increased proximal tubular reabsorption of both sodium as well as lithium. So, if a patient is taking both diuretic as well as lithium, because renal clearance of lithium will be reduced by about 25% by diuretic, you need to reduce the dose of lithium if it is being prescribed along with the diuretic. Because lithium is a narrow therapeutic index drug, there are other alternative to lithium such as valproic acid, which is an anticonvulsant, or carbamazepine, atypical antipsychotics such as risperidone, olanzapine, or clozapine can also be prescribed for the treatment of bipolar disorders. So with this, we have completed our discussion on the treatment of psychosis. Thank you.